Dragon Ball Super Episode 96 is it. The final barrier between the actual beginning of the Tournament of Power and all of the fights that we've been looking forward to seeing. But to dive deeper into episode 96, alright guys, it is Quadman here today giving you a Dragon Ball Super episode 96 breakdown. So without wasting any more time, let's get straight into this video. So starting off with the good, one thing I enjoyed about this episode is the fact that it brought back a reference to the Kachin Medal, as the Grand Priest stated that he was using that to construct the stage. And I felt that that was pretty cool, as we really haven't seen this medal be mentioned in the series ever since the Buu Saga and all of the other Dragon Ball games. And to see that that was actually being used to construct the stage itself means that this medal is really powerful, even up to modern Dragon Ball standards. Also, one cool scene that I liked in this episode is the fact that in testing the actual Tournament of Power itself, we see that three gods of destruction in Ewen, Licker, and Arrak all ended up fighting against each other to actually test the Tournament of Power. And I felt that this sequence had great animation. I loved seeing all of the different beam clashes moving in motion. And in addition to this, I think this was a great preview of the actual Tournament of Power, considering the fact that since they're gods of destruction and you would scale everybody else down proportionately to a god of destruction, if they can only dent the arena, then that means that everybody else wouldn't be able to harm it as much. So that was a good test fight. I thought it was funny how the Grand Priest made these three gods of destruction actually clean the Tournament of Power up, especially considering the fact that these three gods of destruction were all exempt from the Tournament of Power with their respective universes, meaning that they had a good mortal life. So he's literally punishing the guys who had good universes and made them actually clean the Tournament of Power up, and I thought that was pretty cool. But to move on to our Universe 7 fighters, one thing that this episode did very well is it executed the dialogue between Vegeta and Frieza in a very brief and effective manner. We see this as Vegeta was pretty much making fun of Frieza for having a halo, and Frieza was laughing at Vegeta and telling him, "Oh yeah? How about I give you a halo?" And it was just cool seeing that dialogue between both of those characters. And out of all of the Vegeta-Frieza interactions in this episode, when everybody had to get ready to go to the Tournament of Power and hold hands in the process, Vegeta didn't want to hold hands with Frieza, and Frieza was just laughing at him, kind of acting like the alpha dog in the situation, like, "Oh, you're so scared of me, huh?" I just felt that whole rift between both of those characters was very entertaining for this episode itself. But to move on to the Tournament of Power itself, I felt one thing this episode was strong in was reinforcing the limitation on flying in this episode. And there's been a rift in the Dragon Ball community over the last few weeks, last few months, talking about, can you actually fly? And could you imagine the amount of animation horror that Toei would have to go to animate so many characters fighting at once in the air? Like, that would be ridiculous, man. And to talk about the actual gravity itself, I like how the Grand Priest was explaining that the gravity adjusts to what your native planet is. And this is a pretty cool concept, because this is playing with some very complex elements in the Dragon Ball universe, how a world of void can literally adjust itself, or the Grand Priest adjusted it to fit what your native planet was. Like, that means that this took a lot of research and consideration to put all of this into the episode itself. So to me, this was a very interesting concept here. And in terms of pacing, I love the fact that Dragon Ball Super is not wasting any time with both Frieza and Frost, as they're literally going straight to the point. And in terms of meeting the characters themselves, I like the fact that Caulifla was being so sassy with Goku in this episode, as she slaps his hand away as he was trying to meet her. And it adds a lot of personality for Caulifla, but what it really does is this breaks some new information into the Dragon Ball series. This is the first full-blooded female Saiyan that Goku's ever met. Now, obviously, if you count Jiren, that's obviously out of question. And then all of the other female Saiyans that Goku's seen as a baby. I'm talking about as an actual adult being able to completely understand and comprehend what's going on. This is the first female Saiyan that Goku's ever met outside of the hybrids like Bulla and Pan. And it explains why Goku himself was so shocked to see a female Saiyan. So that was interesting. And in terms of Dragon Ball Super hype, I do like how they're literally trying to make Jiren look like the next hit. Because now, with all of the projectiles that were being fired at the Warriors, Jiren immediately like moved out of the way at such a speed that it shocked Goku completely. And I think that this is very similar to Hit, where we see the Tokitobashi, how he was manipulating time. But I think it creates a lot of good hype for the show moving forward. And last but not least, guys, the biggest highlight of this episode itself would have to be the introduction of all of the Universal characters. Now, and I feel like it was very well paced, and it kind of felt like a Pokemon battle where you see like the trainer and the Pokemon like doing a pose as they're like actually going into the fight itself. But to make a breakdown as fair as possible, I'm going to talk about the one and only thing that I felt was bad about this episode. But before we get into that, guys, I genuinely find things to be wrong. And if I don't find anything wrong about an episode, for my thumbnail, I'm going to put bad and put blank by bad. If an episode is perfect and had nothing wrong with it, I will put that. And the one thing I felt was bad about this episode is the fact that when Whis was requesting the Grand Priest to teleport him over to the Tournament of Power, this created a massive problem in explaining the logic of the Dragon Ball Super World and the future Trunks Zamasu arc. You want to know why? Because when Goku Black was going around killing all of the Supreme Kais, which as a result killed all of the Gods of Destruction, first of all, it makes it even more improbable for me to believe the Grand Priest had no idea what was going on. And if the angels can simply request to go over there, they could have requested to go over to the Grand Priest, and the Grand Priest could have teleported over to where Zamasu was, or Goku Black, because it was technically Zamasu and Goku Black's body, and killed him, or get Zeno to kill him. If he can teleport that easily in a completely different universe, it makes no sense how Goku Black managed to do all of what he did without being stopped by the god Zeno or the Grand Priest himself. Sorry guys, I gotta go back to that arc, but it just completely crushes the momentum of the logic of that if he can teleport other people that easily. But honestly, guys, that's pretty much it when it goes for the bad things. I didn't really think anything else was bad about this episode. And to talk about my discussion points, besides Universe 6 and Universe 7, who are you the most interested in seeing from all of the six other universes that will be fighting in the Tournament of Power when you look at Universe 2, Universe 3, Universe 4, Universe 9, Universe 10, and Universe 11, considering the fact that I think that out of these six universes, I think Universe 3 seems to have the most appeal to me because it's a complete team of artificial-like beings that are going to be fighting in the Tournament of Power. And I do kind of like seeing how Nagrishi and Narirama are going to be fighting, being literally programmed to fight in these conditions, especially Narirama, as we saw Nagrishi explaining how he is perfect to fight in this Tournament of Power. So I think the robot-like characters are going to make this really cool, and there's a lot of references that I'm going to explain later on about them. And to do my preview analysis, guys, there's really two things that I saw that really caught my interest in the preview. Other than all of the fights, we see that Zeno is freaking out in this Tournament of Power, and I've already seen people discussing in comment sections how, based on how excited that Zeno looks from this fight, that means that at the end of this Tournament of Power, he would be less likely to possibly kill people. I think that's way too early of a stretch to say that Zeno is going to give everybody a chance just because he's entertained by the fight. But I do think by seeing how glued his eyes were into the battle, that it's a good sign that people at least have a slightly higher chance of surviving simply because he was being so well entertained. And also, guys, one other thing that I noticed in the preview is that Goku and Jiren were both looking at each other, and in the episode, it didn't really look like Jiren was fighting. It looks like he was just kind of standing around there while other battles were going on, and it kind of seems egotistical in a way. Like, Jiren's so OP, like, he's like, yeah, I'm gonna get into the fight when I need to. I'm not gonna, like, waste my time fighting now, and I think that's a pretty cool way to look at this Tournament of Power. This guy is so strong that he doesn't even use his power when he doesn't even think it's necessary. So that's something cool. But overall, guys, I would have to say that this was a solid 4-star episode. It was good. It was very straightforward, and I honestly felt like this episode had to happen. I felt like Dragon Ball Super had to have an episode where they had to set up the Tournament of Power, everybody gets there, we see all these new characters, and they did a good job with it. What kept it from 5 stars was the simple fact that I don't think anything in this episode really amazed me. And to get 5 stars, it has to be something either really memorable or really amazing, and this episode was just good. It was a solid episode, and I don't really think there was that much bad besides the fact that it makes it more unlikely to believe that the Grand Priest and everybody else couldn't have done anything about Goku Black. But other than that, the episode was solid on its own two feet. And check out my video tomorrow where I'm actually going to break down all of the different themes and references of other characters in the other Dragon Ball Super universes themselves. So with everything else said, please remember to rate, comment, and subscribe. And remember, as I always say, to have a great day, guys.